I have found here love and mercy from an infinite supply. I have found here living water from a well that won't run dry. At your feet I bow in wonder. At your feet I place my crowns. Let's surrender be the only sound.
Who can tell us what the name of that song was that Pastor Nathan's playing? Is Our God. A mighty fortress is our God. Isn't that wonderful? And we're here to worship him. I'm Maurice Russell. I know most of you. And if you haven't met me, and if I haven't met you, I'd like to meet you. And I will be after the service. I'll be either in the back there or up here setting up for Sunday school. So please meet me if I haven't met you. In Revelation chapter 5, the elders are representing the church and the people of Israel, and the scripture says they sang a new song. You were slain, speaking of Christ to the Lord Jesus, you were slain and have redeemed us by God, to God, by your blood out of every tribe and every tongue and every people and every nation. Today we are rehearsing for that time when we get to sing together to the Lord Jesus. And we're going to have the words up on the screen. We'll sing to the Lord, we'll study God's word together, and we'll fellowship one with another. So glad to have you here. I'm so glad to be here. And we're going to begin our service at this time.
Good. Reminds me of one of my favorite verses of Revelation there. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. And so many times we say, yeah, God is good, and that's true. But this verse kind of is an annihilation. It kind of starts and it just keeps going. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Thank you, Maurice, for leading us. Let's all stand together as we sing.
Are you? I haven't had the privilege of meeting you. My name is Nate Kemper. I'm the lead pastor here at Now Then Alliance Church, a church that exists to equip people to find life and faith in Christ. And we believe we do that best as we connect with each other, as we grow in our own relationship with God, and as we participate in what God is doing in our lives and in the world around us. If you're here, one of the ways that we love to be able to connect with you is through prayer. And so if you happen to be here and have something you'd like us to pray for that you hope to see God do or celebrate that God has recently done, we'd love for you to fill out this prayer request card and place it in the offering box that's in the lobby behind you. If you're watching online, you can fill that out on our contact form of our website. And if you're looking for the bulletin online, you can find it on the resources tab of our website as well. A couple of different opportunities, some that are just resources available for you as you look to grow in your own relationship with God. We're in the middle with our denomination of 40 days of prayer. Actually, we're just 1 week into 6 weeks of that. And so I'd love for you to sign up for that and join our denomination around the country in that. The easiest way to do that is go to CM Alliance. That's our denomination, Christian Missionary Alliance, cmalliance.org. And you can sign up for it there and you'll get emails of daily devotionals and prayer prompts throughout the 40 days. If that's not something you've done, but you still want to participate, we've printed off weeks two devotions for you. They're on the table in the back in the lobby there, and you can pick one of those up as you go. For some of these remaining 5 weeks of the 40 days of prayer, the sermon will line up with some of what the devotions are talking about. As we talk about our rhythm with God, and particularly in the beginning of this, focus on our rhythm of praying and how we connect with God through prayer, many of the topics will line up in that way as well. A couple of group opportunities for you to grow in your relationship with Christ begin again this week. So Sunday school will take place just after this service in sanctuary here. Pastor Maurice will be leading a class through Genesis 1 through 11. And then downstairs, Sandy Wallace will be leading a Sunday school class that will talk about our relationships and particularly our boundaries that we set in relationships and in connecting with others. And then if you're watching online or if you're here and want to do a Sunday school class at a different time, Pastor Bruce is uploading a Romans class to our website that you can do from a distance and at your own timeline. Similarly, our women's ministry is starting a new study this Tuesday the 12th, and so if you want to sign up for that and order those materials online or show up and begin that process on Tuesday morning, they'd love to have you there as well. There's options in person and options digitally for that as well. And then one opportunity for participation that I want to let you know about coming up in 2 weeks on Sunday the 24th. I've let you know a little bit last week that I'd be holding an event to gather people who want to help plan some of the different kinds of things that will be helpful throughout the year as we look at getting our rhythms in line this year, our rhythms with God, our rhythms with our family, our rhythms with the community of believers, and our rhythms with the community that surrounds us that we hope to impact. And so on Sunday night, the 24th at 6 o'clock, I want to invite any of you to come to that kind of experience and bring your ideas. Those ideas might look like resources you have. Maybe it's a book you read that was helpful for your family to go through together, and you want to have others have the option for that. Or maybe it's events that you hope that the church collectively we would do together. Maybe you brainstorm what it looks like as we aim to connect with each other for us to call restaurants and tell them to expect 100 of us on a Sunday afternoon after church as we all go to eat lunch together and things like that. Come with any of your ideas and brainstorm so that we can figure out which of those to offer to people as a list of resources, which of those there's enough energy around that we should be planning and putting them together. Would love for your help with that. That's Sunday night, January 24th at 6 o'clock. There'll be a dinner provided there, and I'm looking forward to that as well. I've got one other announcement. It's going to take us 4 or 5 minutes, actually, and it's an announcement that's 18 plus months in the making. over a year and a half in the making. As Pastor Rob was navigating how God was calling and discerning his gifts and skill sets in his own life, and as we as a church are always navigating what God may be up to as it pertains to us reaching the community that surrounds us, we've seen in the combination of those two things, God moving. We've then reached out to our district and our denomination and asked them if they've seen the same thing moving that we were discerning God to be moving. And the result of all of those conversations with between God and Rob personally, with us as a church, a leadership collectively, and with us involved in our denomination here in the Twin Cities area and throughout Minnesota and South Dakota, what we've seen is God deciding it's time for a new church to be planted. Particularly a new church to be planted that will reach out particularly with means of compassion towards the homeless population in Anoka. It's a very non-traditional looking church with a very Jesus-centered heart for reaching the lost. And we're excited about the fact that Pastor Rob is going to be the one who will lead that church. That'll take place beginning in this summer, but I'm going to invite Pastor Rob to come join me. He's going to tell you a little bit about what that's looked like as God's been working in his heart as we in the district get ready to send Pastor Rob to do this great work.
Thanks, Nate. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
God has been speaking very clearly over the last, as Nate said, 18-plus months. It's been close to 2 years now since I first heard from God about what this looks like. And at that point, I was just joking with him this morning. He asked how I felt about this, and I said, it feels real now that we're saying things, and that because 2 years ago, as this started to happen and as I started to have conversations with my wife and with Nate, it didn't seem realistic. It didn't seem like this was something that God would actually do. It felt like something that the Holy Spirit might be speaking to me and revealing things. But as time has gone on, God has continued to speak clearly and continued to give confirmations. Specifically over the last year or so, we have started conversations with the district, with the church planting coach. And as those conversations happened, he invited us to go through a church planting assessment that the district holds. I think there was eight assessors and five couples that go through. And it's a 3.5-day intense thing that you get invited to, and you don't really know what's going to happen. They say, hey, come prepared for whatever, like they don't really say much. So we came prepared to experience something that we were unprepared for. And so we got to do different projects, and they saw how we lead and how we work together and what that looks like. And the result of that was their recommendation that we have some personal goals to work towards, but that they would recommend us to lead this church planting effort. And leading up to that was 6 1-hour calls to six of my close friends, and I don't think it could be family, but six close friends or coworkers interviewed about integrity and attitude and skill set and that sort of thing. And so that was a process of understanding, okay, God might be calling us to do something, but do other people see the same thing? And we have received an overwhelming and resounding confirmation time and time again. We got to go on a basics training for a couple days to understand and to start talking through values and that sort of thing. And outside of all those things, God has been opening an incredible amount of doors. There's a homeless shelter called Stepping Stone Emergency Housing. If you're friends with me on Facebook, that might sound familiar. There was a care package event that we did just personally through them. I became aware of the homeless shelter, and so we asked people to give supplies, and we were able to donate 75 care packages just loaded with a bunch of stuff. And that was an example of a confirmation that God said, hey, there is a need here and people are willing to support. But that shelter as well has opened their doors for me to start leading Bible studies there, to begin to serve there and get to know residents. We got to lead a Christmas service for the residents there as well, just me personally. And so there's lots of doors opening and lots of ways that God is speaking clearly to us. And so we have lots of emotions. There's obvious excitement. There's nervousness about what that looks like, right? There's a lot of unknowns in that. And there's a grieving process as well for me personally of recognizing been at Now Then for 5 years with the way 2020 happened. There was a lot of last things that I was hoping I got to experience, like a mission trip, fall retreat, Thanksgiving cook-off, some of the events that that we usually do that I didn't get to experience. And so understanding what this looks like for the next 5 months of how to still continue to pour into teens, but also be obedient to God. We're excited about that. I want to be clear that the burden that God has placed on our hearts for this, I would consider it would be disobedient for us not to do this. That's how strong of a conviction we have about this. And we are so excited about that. 2 weeks from this morning, you'll get to hear me preach and share the vision. There'll be a slide that comes up. So that'll be the first opportunity for you to just hear more about what it is that God has been doing in our lives and what we believe God is doing through us and through the church plant. There'll be a couple informational meetings for anybody to attend. That's to understand how you can partner with us, how you can send us off well. And then there's an interest meeting, and that'll be for people that are more focused on what it looks like to actually go with us. And one of the things I'm incredibly grateful for is the conversations with Pastor Nate and the board. They couldn't be healthier. The relationship, when he says we're sending them, they've opened their arms and said, if people want to go, they can go. If people want to give, they can give. And while that's not going to be the case for the majority of the people to come with us, there might be a call for some people recognizing, hey, I want to do this work alongside you. So excited to share the vision with you in a couple weeks. You can feel free to reach out to me and stop me in the hallway and ask questions between now and then, but that'll be the best way for you to hear more. I'm very grateful for you all, love you all, and appreciate the opportunity to share this with you. So.
We're excited for Rob and Kelsey as they get ready to do that. You heard him say a phrase like, I'll be with you over the next 5 months. The current plan is that Rob would be with us through May. He'll be three quarters time with us. That's a change. He's always been full time with us. He'll be three quarters time with us and a quarter time towards the church planting efforts. And so the district is alongside us in this. And so that's what it'll look like for him between now and May. And the board and I will begin a process on the back end for our own church on what it looks like to be ready in June when Rob has left the role of youth pastor here. And so we'll begin navigating towards that end, but are looking forward towards how you support Rob. Maybe that's in prayer. Maybe that, like you said, is in going to interest meetings, info meetings. There'll be lots of opportunities for that coming up in the next couple of months particularly, but over the course of the next 5 months as we prepare to send him well. One of the other ways we continue to worship is by giving back to God some of what he's blessed us with, being open-handed, not just with people, but with what the things is God has given us. And so if you came prepared to do that physically, you can do that in the offering box that's in the lobby. If you came prepared to do that but not physically, or if you're watching online and want to do that now, you can do that digitally at our website, nowthenalliance.org. There's opportunity to donate and give through as an act of worship that way as well. We want to pray for those gifts. We want to pray for the exciting news of what's taking place in Rob and Kelsey's life and in Anoka. And so I want to invite you to join me in that prayer. God, we're thankful for what you've given to us, and we pray as we give some of it back to you that it would be as an act of worship and that it would be pleasing and acceptable to you. And we pray that you would use these gifts to spread your love and grow your kingdom in a world that could desperately use more of it. And we pray excitedly to see how you've been moving in Rob's life, how you've been moving in our church's life, how you've been moving in our district, to understand that there's a passionate area of lost people that need to be reached in Anoka, and that you're sending workers into that harvest field. And so we pray for Pastor Rob and for Kelsey and their kids as they prepare for this significant adjustment and what their heart's aim and ministry aim looks like. And we pray for fruit there. We pray for that to begin and continue as it has through Bible studies and connections and relationships that have begun with homeless shelters and some of the homeless population there. We pray for more workers to join Rob in this as they plan for what launching a church there would look like. We pray for wisdom and guidance and discernment and blessing. Ultimately, we pray for fruit for your kingdom to come from this work. And we pray that in that, we would understand our role, not just in sending at a point in May, but in partnering for the advancement of your kingdom and your gospel into the future. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to continue to worship God together and would invite you to stand with me as we do that.
Make it ever true.
This morning we're going to continue talking about how our lives are in rhythm with God, or at least how they're supposed to be. And throughout the course of the next couple of weeks and months, we'll find that there's a number of different things we can put into our life, different disciplines and practices, different conversations we can have, or different things God teaches about what it looks like for us to be in rhythm with God. As we begin, though, I think in many relationships, we can tell how good or bad they're going at times solely based on our communication. When you're figuring out if people are talking well or if they're withholding things, if there's a comfort level in what you can say and how you communicate, or if you're distant from each other. A marriage that has two people that live in the same house and same room but don't communicate with each other doesn't look like a healthy, in rhythm marriage. And so as we talk about that, the communication we most often have with God is through prayer. And so for the next few weeks, and particularly alongside the denomination's 40 days of prayer, we'll be talking about a number of different parts and things that apply in our prayer lives. I don't know what a prayer life sounds like or looks like to you. I know in our culture, maybe the most clear way that prayer lives are seen are the people who pray together or pray before every meal, or maybe you pray before bedtime, or maybe you pray when there's a test in school that you need to do well on, or maybe you pray when there's a crisis and ask God to get you out of this, promising how you'll change if He does. Maybe you pray for health. Maybe you pray that God would show you a sign. This is the kind of the most common ways that we see prayer in society: before food, before bed, before a test, right in the middle of a crisis, in a health situation, or when we're desperate for God to do something. Prayer's out of routine. Prayer's out of formula. Prayer's out of desperation. Unfortunately, for many of us, though, they're not prayers out of relationship. They're just prayers. I can remember in college when I would see other people who what I understood about their spiritual life, their communication with God, was that they had relationship I was envious of. It wasn't just because I may see them pray before food or before bed. That was true of, say, my roommate Joel. But I also saw a deep understanding of how God was speaking to him and moving in his life. And that prayer for him wasn't just a list of requests, and it wasn't just an obligation, a formula. After Bible college, when I took my first job as a youth pastor, one of our other staff members, her name was Mandy, I watched her prayer life and watched the way her communication with God felt and looked so different from mine. And I started wondering what that meant. What was I doing wrong? Or how could my prayer life have more life in it? And I started to recognize that there were parts of prayer that Scripture talks about that didn't seem important to me. Parts of communicating with God and my relationship with God that didn't make its way onto my time in prayer. Turns out, what I've noticed is that when the communication feels like you're hiding things or feels like there's certain things that are hard to talk about, it's an easy sign that you're out of rhythm. Before I jump into what that'll mean this morning, I want to just give an example of that through story. When I was about 8 years old and attending elementary school, my parents would pack a lunch for me every day. I brought a lunchbox. It's not one that I used as an 8-year-old, but it's the favorite one I still own. It's got a little ninja on it. And when I would go to school with a lunchbox, it probably had a ninja on it as well. It just likely was a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle instead of this style. And it would have been filled, as appropriate, by my mom. It would have been filled with a sandwich that's healthy and nutritious for me. It would have been filled with something to drink. I don't know, a juice box or something. Probably some kind of chips or side to go with my sandwich. And then my favorite thing to figure out is what Sara Lee or Little Debbie surprise would be in there for me. And when I would get to lunch, I'd spend most of the time there trying to figure out how to trade all the things that weren't my Little Debbie for more Sara Lee or Little Debbie kinds of things. Did somebody want my chips enough that they would give me their zebra cakes? Did somebody want my juice box enough that I could get an extra Swiss cake roll or oatmeal cream pie? And as I would navigate through lunch, I would eat the things that I enjoyed. And yet what I found to have become a pattern was I wasn't eating my sandwich. Somehow, in the mind of an 8-year-old, though, I thought, well, the people at school won't like it and may tell on me if they see me throwing away a full sandwich. And so I formed one of those behaviors that maybe only makes sense to an 8-year-old. I brought the sandwich home every day, but was then convinced my mom would see it if I put it in the trash. So I hid it in my room. I'd open a dresser drawer and throw a full sandwich in it, and then the next day throw another full sandwich in it, and then the next day throw another full sandwich in it. I literally did this until I had a dresser drawer full of sandwiches and needed somewhere else to start putting them. And so I started putting sandwiches in the closet. This went on for months. Months. And I had never gone back and thrown any of the sandwiches away. It came time one day for a deep cleaning of my room, and my mom came in to help me with that. And it didn't take long until she found that I had been hiding months of sandwiches. Imagine the look on her face when you come in and find that your 8-year-old has just been putting his sandwiches in the drawer every day. The first question probably wasn't, why aren't you eating the sandwiches? The first question was probably something like, why are you bringing sandwiches home? How is this a good idea? But I can remember the fear when she found them that I had. Not fear that something largely consequential was going to happen. I knew my parents loved me. I wasn't afraid of some kind of overreaction and discipline or something like that. But I had been hiding this thing, not just physically. Like, I had known that this was something I didn't want my parents to know about for months. And when you're hiding things, sometimes it's because you think there are consequences. But sometimes it's just that feeling of hiddenness, that inability to just be yourself and talk openly and completely and fully, to show all of yourself to another person. That sometimes that's the consequence of itself. The own relationship is just damaged and broken. There are lots of parts to prayer. And we'll talk about a number of them in the next few weeks. Today, I want to talk about what it looks like to be able to be fully open before God. What it looks like to confess the hidden things, to not keep anything away from Him, to have humility in the midst of that. Partly because I think it's important to establishing the right kind of relationship. And like I said, partly because it will line up with what the 40 days of prayer around our country for our denomination is like. And I want to just give one disclaimer before we jump into some of the text. I have zero aim to make us feel guilty this morning. And yet at the same time, when you start talking about confession and hidden sin, and things we've been withholding from God or from each other, there can come a time where the bluntness of that conversation starts to make us feel uncomfortable, and that discomfort often feels or is guilt. It's not the aim or the goal, but our sin, especially our hidden sin, often does that. More importantly, the Spirit of God that reveals our hidden sin often brings that kind of feeling and emotion. We're going to look at today, beginning in Luke chapter 18. Jesus is talking about prayer. Luke chapter 18, we're going to see a couple of verses. He's telling a couple of parables. And so Luke 18, verse 1 says, Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. This is the parable of the persistent widow. We're not actually going to look at that one. Verse 9 then says, after that parable, a second one Jesus is about to tell. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Jesus is teaching on prayer, and the first thing he teaches is that we should pray without ceasing. We should never give up. We should be persistent and always praying. It's a value in our lives. And then the second thing he does when teaching about prayer in this instance is to look at those who have felt confident in their own righteousness and tell them a parable. Here's how that parable begins. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. And the Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, "God, I thank you that I am not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector." Goes on to say, "I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of all I get." This man, in this parable, as Jesus tells it, comes before God, established, he thinks, in his own righteousness, and comes before God essentially to say, "I'm so thankful at how good I am compared to other people. I stand before you confident and in relationship with you because I have behaved better than other people." What we're going to end up seeing is that Jesus sees this as a bad example. To come before God simply listing our accolades and putting down other people, feeling great about who we think we are, isn't the way to start our prayer with God. To be in rhythm with God would have more vulnerability and more humility than that. Jesus shows that with the next example he gives in verse 13. "But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, 'God, have mercy on me, a sinner.'" One man stands before God and says, "I'm so thankful I'm not like other people. Look at those people who are robbers, who are evildoers, who are adulterers, or even they're tax collectors. I'm not like that. I do all the right things. I fast. I give things away. And so I stand proudly and confidently before you." Counterposed with a man who says, "God, here I am. Feels weird at times to even enter your presence because I know how much of a sinner I am. I feel distant at times from you. I don't feel worthy of being in front of you." And Jesus says in verse 14, "I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all those who humble themselves will be exalted." That the point in our relationship with God is that we would come to him humbly, not hiding the things that we're fearful make us look unimpressive before him, not comparing ourselves, not patting ourselves on the back for the couple of things we got right, but fully open with who we are in humility. A parable, it says that Jesus addressed to those who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else. As if you would look around the world today, if you would watch any media, if you would scroll through any social media, what you are likely to find is that as a culture, we've gotten really good at defending what we think we're doing right and pointing fingers at what we think everybody else is doing wrong. And many of us grieve the division that's creating. Not just in our culture and not just in national kinds of news or politics. We see it in our church. Like the global church, the local church, everywhere you go, people confident in their own righteousness, standing before God saying, "Thank God I'm not like them. Those other people who are robbers and evildoers and adulterers. I've done the behaviors that are right and I see what they've done that's wrong." Society's happy to point it out. It's infiltrated the people of God too. Or if we take Jesus at his word, at least in the first century, maybe it started with the people of God. And so the question comes as we think through our own prayer lives, as our own relationship with God, how often do we move from exalting ourselves to humbling ourselves? How do we do that? I think potentially it would start with confession. Reminding ourselves and being fully open with God of our awareness, not just of what we hope for, not just of what we long to be true, not just of what we're thankful for, but also what we recognize as our own true state of being. About a month ago, I was having a conversation with a friend. He's a missionary in Thailand right now, and he had started a company 20 years or so ago that I help raise money for at times, and he, at the end of a project I had done in November, said, "Man, I'm super inspired by what you did. I'd love to connect." And so we got on a call for about an hour together and just talked through what life looks like. And we were talking about what our spiritual lives look like, what our family lives look like, what it looks like to serve God, me as a pastor and him as a missionary in Thailand. And he was talking through just how hard of and challenging of a year he had had. And he boiled it down to this unique revelation God made in his life. Here's what he said about the revelation he felt God make in his life. I started to recognize that most of what I was doing, whether it was in my home life, whether it was in my public life, even as it related to my spiritual life, most of what I was doing, my motivation was to earn accolades and to create an identity for myself. And God had to break me down and remind me that I didn't just need his grace to become a Christian. I need his grace every day. He said, it's almost like I had gotten to this understanding that the gospel of good news was that God extended grace to people who were far from him and distant and not in right relationship with him, and that grace would be extended through Christ, and then you would become a Christian. And after that, I kept thinking that my time then on was about earning God's love, about earning accolades and earning identity. And I had ceased to understand that grace isn't just for the moment of that salvation. That grace is needed every day. That we still need grace, and that we haven't arrived, and that we will only feel fulfilled by the grace of God. As he was saying, and I started to think, oh, I wonder how often I've fallen into that trap of thinking God's grace covered all those other things, but now it's my job just to make sure I'm walking forward in a way that doesn't need grace. He said it, and I just started to think through my own life. When's the last time I prayed and asked God for the grace I know I need? Or have I shown up like the Pharisee and said, oh God, thanks so much, I'm not like them, those other people who need your grace. Those robbers, those evildoers, those adulterers. You see, I don't need that because I fast and I give a tenth of all I get, and I'm a pastor and I show up. And I read your Bible, and I connect with you, and I try to teach my daughter about you. No. I need your grace every day. And so as a part of our communication and prayer relationship, as part of being in rhythm with God, we would confess because we recognize we still need grace. So it's a simple question for us. How often do we repent of the things in our lives? Not just repent in a prayer for salvation, but repent so that we're still in healthy rhythm with God. It's not just something Jesus teaches about his parables. As many of us know, the Lord's Prayer, we see that Jesus teaches about that in Matthew chapter 6. This is how you should pray. It teaches that we should pray about who God is, about God's will being accomplished, about our daily needs being met, and that God would forgive us because we need forgiveness. That he would forgive us, and that moving forward, that we would live out life then and not being led into the temptations we've been falling into. And that would look in our lives often, I imagine, like confessing the things we need forgiveness for. And my guess is, for many of us, if we're not regularly confessing to God in prayer, there's likely two reasons why. Two reasons. The first, the things that we would need to confess, we've been keeping hidden not just from God, but from every part of life as much as possible, and they would be hard things to talk about. That doesn't mean they're always some grave evil thing. Sometimes it's just moldy sandwiches sitting in a drawer somewhere. But we've kept them hidden so long, we don't know how to talk about it. It's uncomfortable. We know it's wrong. It's maybe even this small, weird kind of wrong thing. But we've kept it hidden so long, we don't know how to talk about it, even to God. Sometimes it's the hidden, or it is a hard thing. We don't like it about ourselves. And we feel like not talking about it means we don't have to deal with it. Scarier, we do like it about ourselves. And we feel like talking about it means we have to stop it. Hidden or hard things that life feels better either as we get to do them or as we get to keep them hidden, and so we just don't bring them up and confess about them. That'd be the first reason for some of us that we don't pray confession very often. Second, And if we're not confessing, I would hope that the second reason is the reason why. It's because we don't even know what we're doing wrong. The sin feels unknown to us. Scripture shows some examples of that. Things that people should have known, things that people should be made aware of, things that it seems obvious to the world around you, but for somehow to us, it just isn't a problem. 2 Samuel chapter 12 tells one of those stories. David has had an affair with Bathsheba. He's then to hide that, to keep that hidden from the world around him. He's set it up so that Bathsheba's wife, Uriah the Hittite, would end up dying in battle. He's committed murder. And a prophet alongside him named Nathan is aware of this, trying to get David to understand that what he's done is wrong and that he needs to confess and repent of it. I just want to read some of the results of that conversation. It shows up in chapter 12. It won't necessarily show up on the screen, though. It says this: "The Lord sent Nathan to David, and he came to him and he said, 'There were two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb it had brought. He raised it, and he grew up with him and his children. He shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare the meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb from that belonged to the poor man and prepared it from the one who had come. David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, 'As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this must die. He must pay for that lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity.'" Verse 7 says this is Nathan's response. Nathan said to David, "You're the man. This is what the Lord of God of Israel says. I anointed you king over Israel. I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms. I give you all Israel and Judah. And if all this had been too little, I would have given you even more. Why did you despise the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house, because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your own. You were doing it because it was convenient and easy, and it took a prophet coming and giving stories and parables and analogies to even make you aware of your own sin." What we get to see on the other side of it, though, is David's response. It's recorded for us. Not as clear in this story. We see David understand his own grief and loss and his own need for confession here. But the actual prayer of confession, or song of confession, that he writes is recorded for us in the book of Psalms. Psalm chapter 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassions, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you and you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you're right in your verdict and justified when you judged. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Let me reread two of those verses. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. God, I recognize I am a sinner. That my whole life has been lived that way. And he just begins to confess the act he knows of most recently with Bathsheba and Uriah, the acts he's aware of that have been true as he comes before God humbly in confession. Here's what he says in a little later in that same song of confession, verses 16 and 17. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart you, God, will not despise. God, what I want to offer, what I have to offer, it isn't the tenth that I give. It isn't the fasting. It isn't the sacrifice, the burnt offering, the showing up to church. It's a broken spirit. The contrite heart. A humble recognition of your holiness and my sin. That's what I can bring. That's what I have to offer you. That's what it looks like to be in rhythm with God. To be able to bear all of it and recognizing that even if that means what you're presenting is broken, it's what's best. Later in David's life, he'll write other songs of confession or of understanding of who God is. And as he writes some of them, he talks about what it looks like. In Psalm 139, he reminds us that no matter what we're trying to keep hidden from God, God has seen it. There's no place we go that God isn't aware, that we can't run away from him, that he's known everything before we spoke it or thought it, that he created us and knew all of it before any of it came to pass. And as he's concluding that kind of thought and talking about how God has seen and known and understood all of that, he prays another prayer about these unknown kinds of things, verses 23 and 24 of Psalm 139. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. I don't want to just confess when I know of sins, God, and when I'm in rhythm with you and when I'm in right relationship with you, when I'm communicating with you well. I want all of the hidden things to be made known, even if I'm not aware of them. Search them and find them and show them to me so that I can do better after. Let me be, reveal to me all of my iniquity so that I can move forward from them, confessing of them, repenting and turning from them, and then walking in the way everlasting. This is what it looks like to be in right relationship and in rhythm with God. Not just prayers of request, not just prayers before meals. It includes humble confession of our own sins and our own lives. It's not just David that gives this as an example. Paul does the same. I'm going to read from 1 Timothy chapter 1. This is something Paul says. Here's how he begins it. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Paul says, what I'm about to say, this is important, it's trustworthy, and it deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. Not, thanks God, I'm not like them. Christ Jesus came to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. God's working through our sin, God saving us from our sin, is how the world sees his glory best. It's what Jesus came to do. And so our lives, our prayer lives, our communication with God should include confession of the hidden and the hard things, even of the unknown things. We should be confessing to God. Scripture would say, if we're willing to take it one step further, we shouldn't just be confessing to God, we should be confessing to others as well. This is what he says, book of James, chapter 5, verse 16. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Let me remind us of the ordering of some of that. Jesus isn't saying, if you have already established your own righteousness, then your prayer will be powerful and effective. There's an ordering that says the righteousness gets established as you confess your sins and pray for the forgiveness of them. There's a healing that comes after that. As we get the righteousness of Jesus to us, it's not standing before God and saying, look how righteous I am, listen to my prayer. It's standing before God and saying, I understand how sinful I am, and I need your grace again. Would you extend it to me from Christ? And then as we're made righteous, then our prayers are powerful. That's what it looks like. We would confess, that we'd confess to God, that we would confess to others, that we would, in right rhythm with God, lay bare before him all of who we are, not hiding any of those things. And so we're going to sit for a minute or two here in some uncomfortable silence, where I want to encourage you to do what Jesus says, what David models, what Paul reminds us is true, and to come before God in confession. To do that about individual things in our life, to do that about corporate things and in local churches, the people of God at large, our nation. So I want us to sit. I just want to, for a few seconds, give us a few prompts. Encourage you in this moment, for the next few moments, to take time right now and confess to God your own hidden or hard things. Maybe that looks like confessing any time that you've compared yourself to others as if we're better and that matters. Confessing the sins that we've been unwilling to talk about and reveal. Confessing the sins that we enjoy. Confessing not just our individual sins from our own private lives, but the sins as they take place within the body of Christ. Confessing our selfishness. Any patterns we've had to gossip. Any ways that we've created division or built barriers between ourselves and fellow believers. confessing on behalf of the people of God our own disregard for our first love. Acceptance of false teachings. Our idolatry. Confessing sins within our nation. Injustices, greed, violence. Ignorance of God and his ways, destruction of life, God, it may look different for each of us, and what the list looks like in our own lives. But on behalf of us, I pray that we recognize and confess that we are sinners, the worst of them, that we need your grace, and we need a righteousness that comes from you, and that we want to live in rhythm with you, and that means we will aim to not hide anything. And so forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who have debts against us. And search our hearts and reveal to us any of the places that we're missing the mark. Help us bring those out of darkness and into light so that we can move on from them. We pray it reliant on your grace and your power. Asking it in Jesus' name, amen. Before you go, three quick things. If you're looking to help grow in your relationship or put this message into practice, I'd encourage you to just choose one of them. Some feel very hard. Some may feel easier. First, if you're looking to connect with someone else, I'd encourage you, confess your sins to someone and pray for each other so that you may be healed. You may recognize that's not a unique application I've created. I've stolen it from James, chapter 5, verse 16. Second, if you're just looking to grow, I'd encourage you to read Psalm 51 in five different translations. Not because there's a power in the number five, just to reflect on the language David is using as he's confessing and have opportunity for you to find some of that language maybe for your own prayer life. Or third, as you're looking to participate, I'd encourage you to utilize the 40 days of prayer devotions from our denomination this week. They're on repentance and what that looks like individually, collectively, corporately. If you need those in print, there's some available here in the lobby behind us. If you need them online, go to cmalliance.org. You can sign up for them there and they'll get emailed to your inbox. I'd encourage you to participate in those throughout the week. As you go with grace and peace. Go in right rhythm with God, even as it starts through confession to him. You are dismissed.